pretty cool so far. And that's just the first patch. Welcome to the party, pals. I am Droid. Today we're checking out the Syntronik V-80 synthesizer based on the Yamaha CS-80, GX-1, and CS-01 synths. Now I'm pretty excited to be back in synth land. And this one was requested / recommended. Thank you very much, my friend, for the suggestion. I cannot wait to check it out. But before we get into the sounds on this one, we gotta do some research first. So if you're new to my synthesizer videos, what I like to do is start off by doing a little bit of research on the synthesizer, learn a little bit. Hopefully, maybe you'll learn something as well. If you're interested, I have already checked out several of these synthesizers from Syntronik. Those videos are available on my channel. See, we still got all these to check out. I think we still have about 30 V80. There we are. Quick note, this research section is going to feature an extensive amount of talking. I have chapters available on the video if you'd like to skip ahead. If you're not interested in a history lesson on these synthesizers, research Exhibit A, IK Multimedia's website, Syntronik Instruments V80. From Toto to Vangelis, the Syntronik V80 is based on the classic Yamaha CS-80, GX-1, and CS-01 synths. Manufactured from 1976 to 1980, the CS-80 was Yamaha's flagship take on the analog polysynth. The CS-80's voice architecture is an exercise in layering, filtering, and modulation. Each selectable-shape oscillator has its own high-pass and low-pass filter and envelope controls. The sound is fat and organic, and even the slightest introduction of the resonant high-pass filter can add a phasey quality to the instrument that gives it even more depth. Some examples of its unique sound can be heard in Bladerunner and Mutiny on the Bounty by Vangelis, as well as Dune by Toto. Alright, I'm not familiar with Dune. I've never seen that movie. None of the versions of it. I believe the one that Toto worked on was directed by David Lynch, wasn't it? Which I am a big fan of David Lynch. Love me some Twin Peaks. I still have not had the opportunity to rewatch Blade Runner. Wasn't available on any streaming service. And Mutiny on the Bounty, I'm not familiar with that either. There you have it. The GX1 is not exactly 2.25 CS-80 synths, but that comparison is a good place to start. 2.25, that's interesting. Manufactured in extremely small quantities at an enormous price tag, it was only used by the most premier artists in the late 70s, such as Keith Emerson, Stevie Wonder, Led Zeppelin's John Paul Jones, and ABBA's Benny Andersson. Thus far, this is looking like it's going to be a good one for me to learn some stuff. Admittedly, I'm not familiar with Keith Emerson. Is that Emerson, Lake, and Palmer? So I don't know if I know any songs there. Obviously, I know who Stevie Wonder is. Superstitious. Apologies to Stevie Wonder for that rendition. I am quite familiar with Led Zeppelin. And ABBA is something that I've been meaning to check out, because I know John Carpenter has mentioned ABBA. So perhaps now is the time for me to check out some ABBA. Nice little 3D render there. The unit sampled for Syntronik belonged to John Paul Jones, then Keith Emerson, then film composer Hans Zimmer, masterful composer right there, before being sold to two other owners. By contrast, the tiny CS-01 is a simple single oscillator, monophonic analog synthesizer with a selectable shape waveform going into a four-pole resonant filter. It has a single LFO, single envelope generator, and is a highly musical sounding synthesizer despite its diminutive size. That's pretty cool. The one that they sampled for Syntronik is the one that was owned by those guys. Over 1.5 gigabytes of content, over 2,000 samples, 140 instrument presets in total. So by the sounds of that, I wonder if we look up Wikipedia for the CS-80, will that give us the GX-1 and CS-01, or do we have to look that up too? All right, research portion 2, my favorite source, Wikipedia. The Yamaha CS-80 is an analog synthesizer introduced by Yamaha Corporation in 1977. It supports true 8-voice polyphony with 2 independent synthesizer layers per voice, each with its own set of front panel controls, in addition to a number of hardwired preset voice settings and 4 parameter setting stores based on banks of sub-miniature potentiometers. Rather than the digital programmable presets featured on the Prophet 5 introduced soon after. The previous video I did in the Syntronik series here was on the Prophet 5, and in the research portion of that we learned about microprocessors, storing presets, very interesting stuff. Moving on, it has exceptionally complete performer expression features, such as a layered keyboard that was both velocity sensitive, like a piano's, and pressure sensitive, aka aftertouch. But unlike most modern keyboards, the aftertouch could be applied to individual voices rather than in common, and a ribbon controller allowing for polyphonic pitch bends and glissandos. We got a new word to look up, yeah. We learned about the portamenti in the Oberheim video. Now we're going to learn about glissandos. In music, a glissando, plural glissandi, an abbreviated gliss. I'm going to look up a pronunciation on this. Glissando, according to the pronunciation man, is a glide from one pitch to another. So what's the difference between a glissando and a portamento? Does anybody know this information? Oh, in some contexts, it is equivalent to portamento, which is a continuous, seamless glide between notes. In other contexts, it refers to discrete, stepped glides across notes, such as on a piano. I tell you what, this is why I love doing these videos. I love learning new things, whether it's words, songs, music. Doesn't matter. Production of the instrument ceased in 1980. What a bummer. Vying the sequential circuits Prophet 5 and Oberheim OBX polysynths for the title, the CS-80 is often described as the preeminent polyphonic analog synthesizer. So we have covered both the Oberheim and the Prophets right here on my channel. So it's interesting that all of these are getting brought up and intertwined, and together with the monophonic Moog modular synthesizer, commands amongst the highest resale price of any synthesizer. That's pretty cool. Creating something that stands the test of time and appreciates in value, and that is still being talked about many years later. It's got to be the ultimate goal, right? That's pretty cool. Vangelis. I wonder if I'm even saying Vangelis correctly. That would be unfortunate. Apologies to Vangelis. Let me look that up. Alright, so according to voice pronunciation lady, she says it's Vangelis. So now it's her fault if I'm saying it incorrectly. Blame has been displaced. The Greek composer Vangelis used the Yamaha CS-80 extensively. He described it as the most important synthesizer in my career, and for me, the best analog synthesizer design there has ever been. That's a bold statement right there. The CS-80's features can be heard on the Bladerunner soundtrack by Vangelis, in which CS-80 is featured prominently, as well as the composer's soundtrack for the film Chariots of Fire, which I have not seen, and the bass line of Peter Howell's interpretation of the 1980 theme tune to the BBC science fiction show Doctor Who. Haven't seen a single episode of Doctor Who. Would you believe it? So now, looking at this little box here, see what additional information we have. Price, US $6,900 doll hairs. That's a lot of bread. Okay, so they got the C also GX1 right here, which is also part of the Syntronik V-80. First released as Electone GX707, is an analog polyphonic synthesizer organ developed by Yamaha as a test bed for later consumer synths and Electone series organs for stage and home use. The GX1 has four synthesizer ranks, or three manuals, called solo, upper, and lower, plus pedal and an analog rhythm machine. The GX707 first appeared in 1973 as a theater model for use on concert stages before the GX1 was publicly released in 1975. Holy Shinto, look at that price over there. 60,000 doll hairs. I'm seeing what they meant about the 2.25 CS-80s. Look at that monstrosity right there. This thing's pretty impressive. All four ranks use a common voice card design called a tone generator in Yamaha parlance to produce their sounds. Each voice card features a voltage-controlled oscillator with multiple waveforms, two-pole high-pass and low-pass voltage-controlled filters, and two envelope generators for filter modulation and VCA control. There is also a variable bandpass filtered sawtooth wave and high-pass filtered square wave on each card. There are a total of 36 voice cards in a GX1, containing 36 oscillators, 72 envelope generators, and 144 filters. This thing is wild stallions. Due to the extensive use of epoxy-potted submodules, a complete set of GX1 voice cards alone weighs more than a Polymoog. Preset sounds are stored on tone modules, small cartridges which each contain 26 fixed-value resistor dividers. These produce voltages that drive the voice cards, each resistor controlling one parameter of the sound. The tone modules are installed in compartments on the top panel of the synth. An optional tone board programmer could be inserted in place of a tone module, providing a full set of knobs, switches, and sliders to control the parameters of a tone manually. This thing just gets crazier and crazier. Tones created this way could then be programmed onto a variable tone module using the tone module setting box. The GX1 console weighs 300 kilograms. The pedal board and stand add 87 kilograms, and each of its two powered speakers, four of which can be connected to the GX1, weighs 141 kilograms, which together equals a total of 951 kilograms, or 2,096 pounds. Goodness gracious! Could you imagine having to transport that mother? The GX1 costs 60,000 doll hairs, equivalent to 412,000 doll hairs today. That is insanity. And was premiered in the US in 1973 at the NAMM convention. The exact production number is unknown, but thought to total fewer than 100. Yeah, I can see why. I wonder if the one that was owned by Hans Zimmer and John Paul Jones and Keith Emerson, I wonder if that was a CS-80 or was that a GX-1? They didn't specify that. Notable users. A number of artists used the Yamaha GX-1 extensively in their recordings. Keith Emerson of Emerson, Lake & Palmer. There you go. Nailed that one. In their albums Works Volume 1 and 2, Love Beach, and In Concert. They actually took this mother on the road. What? In Concert? Yeah, it's a live album by Emerson, Lake & Palmer. So they took this thing out on the road. Emerson described touring with the GX1 as a roadie's nightmare because of its 600-pound mass. Hans Zimmer later bought one of Keith Emerson's old GX1s. So that answers the question there. That's pretty crazy that IK Multimedia sourced one of these things. Because, I mean, 412,000 doll hairs? I guess thank you, IK Multimedia. I hope you made your money back. I certainly helped out a little bit. John Paul Jones of Led Zeppelin used a GX1 on their 1979 album, In Through the Outdoor. Jones also used it on Led Zeppelin's 1979 concerts at Nebworth. He later sold his to Keith Emerson. So that's the one right there. Stevie Wonder is said to have bought two, one of which is on display at Madame Tussauds in Las Vegas. He referred to the GX1 as the Dream Machine because of its three keyboards that allowed him to layer different sounds simultaneously and allowed him to create lush and very convincing orchestral sounds. Wonder used the GX1 in particular on his 1976 album, Songs in the Key of Life. That's a good album title right there. Don't think I've ever listened to that one, however. And his 1979 soundtrack album, Journey Through the Secret Life of Plants, one of the two, is now owned by Pete Townsend of The Who. Benny Andersson of ABBA used a Yamaha GX1 on several ABBA tracks as well as on tour. I can't believe all these people toured with this thing. That's crazy. He still keeps it at his... Not even gonna attempt that one. Maybe I am. Rick Smixningsverket. Did I botch that pronunciation or did I nail it? In Stockholm, along with many other old synthesizers and keyboards, Hans-Jürgen Fritz of Triumvirat. My apologies to anybody that I offend with my pronunciations in this video. This is wild stuff. Rick Vanderlinden, I like that name, rolls off the tongue of Exception, whose solo album GX1 was played entirely on it. He must really have liked that thing if he named his whole album after it. Richard Wright of Pink Floyd allegedly owned one for a brief time, but it did not make an appearance on any recordings. It can be seen pictured in the album sleeve of Is There Anybody Out There? The Wall Live, 1980-81. Interesting stuff. So I think we pretty much covered all this information here. I don't know how we couldn't have with all that reading I just did. All right, I could not find a Wikipedia article on the CS-01. So the only information we have is this little section right here. So I guess that will conclude our research portion. Now let's proceed to the sound demo. Let's have some fun now. All right, so quickly go over the features of Syntronik. Here you got the actual synthesizer where you can twist some digital knobs and apparently in this one slide some digital sliders. You also got this little keyboard here if you want to tap on your mouse, play some notes. They also have this edit panel that has more settings than you could probably ever want in your life. It'll have you tweaking digital knobs till the end of time. They got this nice little effects section which provides a whole bounty of effects such as amps, distortion, dynamics and EQ, modulation, reverbs and delay, and filters. They also have a built-in step sequencer. They have this massive list of presets here. And this right here, very importantly, is a panic button in case you find yourself getting annihilated by a wall of sound. It will immediately stop all notes from playing. Very useful. I know from experience. You've also got this section right here, which allows you to separate your keyboard and have different patches or instruments applied to different sections of your keyboard. You can also split it up to have different octaves. If you have a condensed keyboard, you can have some super low octaves and super high. Very useful stuff. And that pretty much covers the features of Syntronik. I have loaded up the first preset. Let's go ahead and take a listen. Pretty cool so far, and that's just the first patch. It's pretty inspiring. I'm digging it. Kind of reminds me of Super Metroid. That's the best I could do just based on my memory without actually going back and playing the game or listening to the main title theme. Close enough to not trigger a copyright. Am I right? Well, let's check out another patch. ¶¶ glissando. Pretty interesting. Those low notes are juicy. Burger eating bastard right there. You bastard! How dare you interrupt my synthesizing? That's a pretty sick bass right there. If you got a sub, probably feel that one. If you don't have a sub, it probably looks like I'm just hitting keys with no audio. I wonder how low this goes. Love a good sub bass. Why are we including the Pro VS? Get it out of here. Drunk keys. This one sounds like a Fear Factory song. Get to the chopper! right here. Do it. Sound effects too. Not my favorite.
Yeah.
Terra, baby. Didn't think that would happen tonight. Pretty funny description right there. Someone dropped your beautiful tube bass amp, hit it with a sledgehammer, and then drove over it with their car. Now, why would you do something like that?
Thank you.
with all these whiny patches. Bastard! How dare you interrupt my synthesizing? A lot of similar ones as we're getting down to the bottom here. Just huge blocks of very similar presets. See the step sequencer in action.
Mm-hmm.
We have reached the end of the presets. I'm pretty impressed with this thing. I don't know about you. Yeah, there were some repeat sounds, some very similar sounds towards the end there. But all in all, there's a large variety of presets. I mean, this thing is pretty diverse. And that was just the presets. Imagine what you could get by tweaking the digital knobs and sliders. This may wind up being one of my favorite synthesizers when all is said and done, when we've checked out all 34 Syntronik synths. I really enjoyed checking this one out. Thank you again, my friend, for recommending it / requesting it. Definitely very inspirational. A lot of life in this one. But yeah, that's where we're going to wrap this one up. Once again, I have been Droid. I hope you enjoyed the video. Check out my channel for more Syntronik videos, as well as guitar and drum videos. If you would like to request or recommend the next synthesizer that I do in the Syntronik series, let me know and I will gladly put that one at the top of the list. Still having a great time with Syntronik, doing all the research, learning some stuff, the history of these synthesizers. It's a lot of fun. Also, please check out my music on Spotify, Apple, YouTube, etc. under Droid, J-R-O-I-D, Linktree/Droid, links are in the description. Thank you for watching, I appreciate you taking the time to do so, and as always, stay safe, take care.